Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because we have Jim Fyfe here. Jim is a personal presentation coach. He's coached very successful TED Talk authors, including Susan Cain, whose book Quiet led to unbelievable TED Talk that received more than 25 million views. So very excited to talk to him. And then after we talk to him, I'm going to give you a little information about how to create a radio show and podcast. So this is going to be quite the show for people who are interested in speaking, doing TED Talks, doing radio, and so much more. So stay tuned, and we'll be back right after this.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Jim Fyfe, who is a personal presentation coach. He has coached clients from business, medicine, arts, education for TED and TEDx talks, including Susan Cain, whose TED Talk has drawn over 25 million views. He was consulting producer on the Bravo TV series Andy Cohen's Then and Now, and the segment producer on The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. He's done so much. I could read your bio all day, so I am going to just welcome you to the show, Jim. It's so nice to have you here.
Thank you. No, thanks, Diane.
I was looking forward to it. You know, you have such an interesting background. I know you've done everything from theater to, you know, what I said as far as late night shows, and you've worked as a writer, performer, producer, you name it, director. I mean, it's so 20 years in that film and that realm, and then now you're helping people do a lot of the presentation things that you're so used to doing. So this is going to be great. I just want to get a backstory, though, because I know that you've done so many things, and I just want to know what led to your interest in going in the Hollywood direction and then this direction.
Oh, I see. First of all, this is great, and I'm very thrilled to be on your show. So thanks for inviting me.
Oh, you're welcome.
I started off, you know, I was like a lot of little kids. I was putting on plays in my basement when I was in fourth grade, and so I became, you know, I started doing plays in high school. I decided, I bitten by the bug, I wanted to be an actor, and my parents, you know, after making a little bit of noise about how insane a choice that is, they let me. So I went off and majored in theater and speech at a small college in Pennsylvania, and I was lucky enough to get out of there and begin getting, you know, some work in New York City. And so over time, I started getting more work in theater, and that led to Broadway. That led to a little bit more of television and film. And I did that till the early 90s. Then I moved my family to Los Angeles, and I was doing that, you know, TV and film really full time during most of the 90s. And somewhere along there, I just sort of fell out of love with being an actor. I just didn't want it anymore. I was able to support my family the whole time, but I didn't want it anymore. And I wasn't sure what would replace it. So I began to write and produce a little bit in television. And I thought that was going to be the direction I was going. And then in the early 2000s, a bunch of things happened, not the least of which was that my late wife was diagnosed with cancer. So I had to rethink things in a big way. Thank you. And I ended up as a classroom teacher. I ended up teaching history, which I don't even have a degree in an independent school. So I think one thing that I tell younger people is you never know what you're being trained for. And I think I was kind of going away from acting and more towards personal presentation, presenting information, presenting stories in a way that's going to connect with people, and more to the point, that's going to be useful to other people. So being an actor, you kind of have to be sort of me. But I think as I was growing and maturing, I think I was going in a direction that was more about you, or them, you know. So I began teaching classroom stuff, and then the personal presentation coaching literally fell in my lap when I got a call about, I have to give this talk, mm-hmm. and I'm terrified, and can you help me? And that's how it started.
I bet you get a lot of those now. I mean, so many people are freaked out about giving TED Talks. I've had some of the best speakers on my show, but they said, you know, that's a little different when you have to have a specific exact amount of time and memorize in a way, you know, and it's a lot different than a traditional stand on a stage in front of a corporation talk, right?
I think it is, mm-hmm. but I also think in the end, you have something to say, and you figure out how best to say it. And that's really all I do. That's literally on my website. You have something to say, I'm here to help you say it. So I think that if you're really focused on what do I have to say, what do I need to say today to these people, then you're really keeping your eye on the ball. You're keeping your focus on where it's going to be most productive. And the problem is, in a high stress environment like giving a talk or giving a TED talk, you get over focused on like all this other stuff, and you take your eye off the ball. The ball is, what do I need to say? And if you keep it on that, a lot of other problems can be dealt with much, much more easily.
Yeah, it's kind of like golf. You know, you got all these things are trying to tell you at once, and then you've got you're not looking at the ball. But I saw a video that you were with Susan Cain that you said, mm-hmm. just tell the truth. And that's what people want to hear. And I know Susan did very well. Her book, Quiet, was, you know, a great book. I loved it. I interviewed Ken Fisher of Fisher Investments, said it changed his life. I mean, Susan's work has been very inspirational. But she's not a super dynamic person. She's kind of I've watched her in person at events. But I loved her because she was very much who she is. She doesn't try to be, you know, Robin Williams or somebody else, you know. And I think a lot of people try to... they like the Zig Ziglars, or they like certain people, and they try to be that. Is that a big mistake?
It is a big mistake. You're absolutely right. Yeah, you're there to tell the truth, and that implies you're there to tell what's true for you. And again, in a TED Talk, there's almost always some personal element to it. You're trying to bring the audience closer to you or get closer to them by sharing something of yourself. And you know, everybody is the world's leading authority on them, you know, your thoughts, your feelings. So again, if you keep your focus on that, and yes, knowing who you are, that's what's really great. Is like, if you were trying to be something that you're not authentically, the audience will know, and they'll disconnect from your message. So you really just have to speak as yourself. Luckily, we're living in a time when even someone with a quiet speaking voice or who's not demonstrative, technology of wearing a microphone that's literally right next to your mouth or that's attached to your chest, it allows, you know, you don't have to do things that speakers in an earlier era had to do. Technology is going to help you if you let it. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's another part of what I do, is helping people understand what they have to do and what they don't have to do.
Well, you know, in some kinds of talks, there's a lot of back and forth. On a TED stage, it's all one-sided. But I know a lot of people who are listening give speeches and where there's Q&A. And I know you taught improv until COVID. Are you back to teaching it again or not yet?
I'm not yet. Uh-huh. Yeah, improv is like, I think if everybody in the world took an improv class once a year, I think things might be much, much better. Because it's just about rolling with what is actually happening right in front of you. That's really all it is.
Yes, and.
There you go. There you go.
I took one last year before COVID, and it was the most fun. It's just... I mean, I was in sales for decades, so you had to kind of know improv in some respects.
Right.
You had to
pretty
much be positive and go in another direction. It's almost like, here's my keys, look over here, as you would with a baby. But I love those guys. Oh, what's your line thing? What's the show? I love those guys.
Whose line is it anyway?
That,
yes.
I could watch those guys all day. But
yeah.
There's some great people who I'm sure you've witnessed who are able to improvise. Robin Williams was amazing as Jonathan Winters. And was there anybody who really stood out in your mind as just being so great at that?
Well, I mean, you know, a great American actor who got his start doing improv, and people tend to forget, is Alan Arkin.
Because
Alan Arkin, you know, was an original member of the Compass Players in the 1950s. Mm-hmm. And, you know, those people, Mike Nichols, who became a major American director, and his partner, Elaine May, what they were doing was taking something, improv has always existed, but they were taking it and they were kind of molding it into a very specific form of entertainment. But, you know, I think it has a lot to offer in terms of just everyday life, of saying yes to whatever's happening. So I respect all those people. Earlier, many years ago, I was lucky enough to see some of those original people from the late 40s and 50s who had kind of created what we think of as improv. They came to New York and they did a show. And so it was people like Paul Dooley and Severn Darden, and some of these are people who were present at the creation mm-hmm. of American improv. And what was impressive to me was that none of those people was trying to hog the spotlight. One great thing about improv is it's collaborative. If you're standing there doing all the talking and your partner is not actively participating in the scene, it's not real improv. It's stand up with a special guest star.
Yeah.
And so the people that really did this with integrity were team players. And so the scene didn't exist unless it existed between two people, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, no, it does. And Alan Arkin, I love. I just came to mind him in So I Married an Axe Murderer. He cracked me up in that. But he's been in so many wonderful things. And he's a great actor. But I was thinking of my favorite shows when I was young. I used to love to watch Dick Van Dyke Show, Carl Reiner, Mel Brooks stuff, all those.
Yep.
It's a little different now. And I was watching one of your talks about how... You know, Tim Conway would crack up and when they're on the Carol Burnett show and all that stuff. But you were really impressed by the Will Ferrells and the Kristen Wiigs and the people who just stay completely dedicated and focused.
Yep.
I mean, it's got to be hard, though, when everybody's saying really funny things around you.
It is. But again, I guess it's the same thing as I would say to a speaker, which is, you know, what are you here to do?
Mm-hmm.
Are you here to enjoy yourself? Well, that's nice, but you can do that at home for free. I really, you know, again, that Tim Conway thing, even as a little kid, I was like, well, this is fun to watch one time, but like they did this last week and now
time.
They're cracking
up
again. Aren't these people getting paid a lot of money for this to entertain me, not to entertain themselves? So it's just a pet peeve of mine. And again, like I say, the people that I really admire are those people who are really focused on what they're there to do. And it's the same thing with a speaker.
Do you think it's kind of like how Jimmy Fallon would crack up? That are they doing it for real, or are they really cracking up, or are they playing to the audience, trying to make them laugh at them laughing?
I have no idea what Jimmy Fallon's actually like. I've never met him, but mm-hmm. I know that I can tell you that when Stephen Colbert cracks up on the air and can't get through something, he truly is cracking up, because he's got great discipline, and not for nothing, he comes out of the improv world of Chicago too.
What kinds of things would make him crack up?
Oh, that's a good question. You know, people he knew, when Steve Carell came on the show, he couldn't, mm-hmm. they can't even look at each other on stage without cracking up.
Well, I think that it's fun to watch comedians. I'm sometimes disappointed, you know, when they interview them, though. They're so serious. I think I heard Will Ferrell once on Howard Stern, where maybe he just didn't like Howard, but he was very serious, and he hardly would answer the questions. It was like, and then I've seen him on other things where he's super outgoing and funny. So I'm wondering, what's the real side? Do you think some of them put on a side for talk shows, or is that who we are? We seeing the real people?
Oh, I definitely think that there's a there. You know, I produced over 100 segments on that show, something like that. And I produced Will Ferrell. I produced Ted Cruz. I produced Elvis Costello, lots of different people. Hmm. So there are lots of people who come in, especially the actors or comedians, sometimes will have sort of like a shtick that they do, that they know kind of how to do or that works for them. Other people just come in wide open and like, okay, well, you know, we'll talk about whatever you want, you know. So it's very different. Will Ferrell, when I worked with him, he was, you know, just like a team player guy. He showed up. He's like, okay, what do we want to do? We're going to do this. Let's do that. He was great. So I also think it's like anything else. It's like, what, you know, did they just have a fight with their boyfriend or girlfriend or something?
Right.
You know, sometimes you get somebody on a bad day, but
yeah.
You know, yeah. So
I think he is hysterical. And I think, you know, I think of all the comedians and people who were great. And I actually took that masterclass by Steve Martin. I don't know if you've seen it, but he does a how to do comedy masterclass. And Steve Martin was terrific, I thought, and still is. He can be very serious too, though. Do you find a lot of these comedians are kind of serious if you see them outside of being on stage?
Yes. Yes, I do. But I think there's maybe armchair psychology about like people's demeanor and stuff like that. But I know that there's like for somebody like Steve Martin and somebody like Will Ferrell, for anybody that's a funny person, there's a craft to it. And you have to fail a million times before you really begin to get a sense of how it works and also how it works for you. Steve Martin bit would be different than a Will Ferrell bit, right?
Mm-hmm.
Each person has to find their style. So for a speaker like, say, Susan Cain, you know, she's not going to be able to do some kind of performance comedy thing, but
right.
she can say something witty,
right?
You know, because she's super smart.
Mm-hmm.
So it's also about each person knowing what kind of funny they are or what kind of funny they can be.
You know, one of my favorite comedians was George Carlin. He just could memorize these long, these rants. I don't know how else to call them, you know. I mean, I know I could never do. I'm not very good at memorizing, and I'm sure a lot of people have struggled with that. I noticed when I first started speaking, I tried to memorize and then I was very boring and it was not good. So if you're trying to be a good speaker, where does memorizing come into place? Do you try to memorize in chunks? Like, I know this story takes 3 minutes and that, how does it work?
Well, I think, not to give a short or a glib answer, but it's going to work many different ways.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, the great advantage of what I do is that I work with the writer and the speaker are the same person.
Mm-hmm.
So the writer has to do their job first. What do you want to say? And that's in my work. You know, I don't just work on what do I do with my hands. I want to work with people all the way from writing their speech to the final delivery, because then you're really shaping something that's organic. But it begins with what you want to say. So the writer has to do their job of getting it clear. Now that can mean writing out every single word until we just keep batting it back and forth and editing and editing and editing until it's really crystallized and super, super clear exactly what you want to say. But then the next phase is the speaker takes it over, and words that worked on a page, rhythms that worked on a page, won't necessarily work as spoken words or as embodied words, because when we're speaking, we're delivering more information on more frequencies. There's not just the words we're speaking, there's what are we doing with our hands? What's our face doing? How close? How far away? What's our body doing? So we're delivering more information. And that means that things sometimes don't need to be said directly, or things can be said in a slightly different way because we have more tools of expression delivering the message. So in between there is what you're calling memorization. But mm-hmm. to me, when you're working with somebody that's written something, and frequently I work with people who've written a book or, mm-hmm. you know, you're right. talking about something you've invested years of right. your life in. You already own it. You could, if you had a gun to your head, you could talk about it to somebody right now. Mm-hmm. All we're trying to do is make a nice cake with beautiful icing that like really, really will present this thing in the best possible way. So memorization can happen lots and lots of ways. But, you know, when I work with a client in an ideal setting, when somebody comes to me and says, I have this thing in 2 months, can you help me? We really spend a lot of time on the writing. And you can end up with a script that you want to memorize, or you can end up with bullet points that you want to hit. And you're just going to, if you're a fluid conversationalist in life, then we would work on it from that aspect. I always try to just build out from where the person is already strong. And yeah. then we just kind of add to that. So there's going to be all kinds of ways to get that thing in your head so that you know what's the next thing you have to say. You know, and that you don't get
there's not a lot of cues, you know. I mean, like I was thinking one of my first talks was for Forbes, and I was on stage and they gave me, you know, PowerPoint they created, and I'm thinking, oh good, I'll look at the PowerPoint to tell where I am in my talk, you know, even though it was just pictures or whatever, it would kind of tell right. me where I am.
Right.
They put behind me on this huge screen with the bright lights in my face, and there was no way for me to see it.
Right.
And and of course I can't see without my glasses up close to have notes or anything in front of me. And so I mean, it was a very humbling, you know, like this is what it could be like experience. And I think I've often thought of doing a TED talk on my work with curiosity, since nobody's done the research I've done and nobody's written from my book, you know. And mm-hmm. so when people interview me, I often prefer, they'll say, let's get together, we'll talk about what you want to talk about. I'm like, no, just ask me whatever you want. I do better if I don't know what you're going to ask me.
Right.
I just, maybe from being in sales, I'm used to working like that, you know. But do you find most people want to know a lot of what to expect? I mean, when they're giving any kind of a talk outside the TED experience, of course, because that's unique.
Sure. Well, first of all right, I'll start answering this, and then I want to go back to what you just talked about being stuck on stage with the PowerPoints.
Okay.
People generally want to know what to expect, mm-hmm. but I also try to work with people in such a way that, like, look, stuff can go wrong. You know, you can have a microphone that doesn't work, or you know, the power goes out in the building where you're supposed to speak, or they put you on a different stage at the last minute. That's why my core concept is be grounded in what you are here to do. What truth are you here to tell today? And you own it, because it's either your personal story plus research you've spent years writing about, or it's your, you know, it's personal to you. Mm-hmm. So you're here to deliver it. And right. that's, and in a way, it becomes not personal to you, because it's like, look, if I just have to take a letter and take it upstairs and put it on my wife's desk, that's really all I'm doing, is I'm delivering something. So it's just like, focus on delivering what you're here to deliver. And what was true yesterday is true today, and it'll still be true tomorrow. So it's like Zen archery, where they teach people you hit the middle of the target by aiming past the target, by aiming through it. You're not just focused on this one thing right here. It's, to some degree, when I'm working with people, it's about them and it's about their life's work, which they own when they're sleeping. So it's really, it's not easy, but it is like, if you just keep your eye on that message that you're here to deliver, then if the mic goes out or something, there's some interruption, you're not spinning off, because it's not about a mic. It's about what you're here to say. Does that all make sense?
Yeah, and I think you could always call out the elephant in the room in a lot of, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah. Transparency is one of the most powerful things I've ever seen. I frequently tell people, if you're nervous, if you're really nervous when you go out there, say it.
Right.
And say it among one of the third, say your name, say good morning, say your name, and then say you're nervous, because everybody in the audience will sympathize with
you. They're rooting for you. Right. Yeah. I love the guys. Thank you to the three people in the back who clap kind of thing, you know, when you're your joke doesn't go over.
So what did you do when you were on stage and you had these PowerPoints behind you and bright lights in your face? How did you solve
Well, you
that
could
problem?
Actually watch it somewhere. It's on YouTube. Every once in a while, I turned around to look at that PowerPoint because I couldn't remember, you know, and I would never want to do that, but I knew I had to in a couple places. But in general, I knew what I had to say. I mean, I had practiced it to some extent. I just never had spoken before. I was volunteered for this. It was a subject I didn't even know. You know, there was a lot of things that were, you know, new to me. And it wasn't my finest hour, but when I watched it, it wasn't as bad as I thought it would be. I tend to be very hard on myself, and then I'll watch it later. I'll go, okay, well, that wasn't that bad, I guess. Good. You know, I compare myself to me, though, you know, and I know what I'm capable of, and then I go, oh, well, that's bad because that's not what I am capable of. I wish I could be Will Ferrell or somebody else, but I, you know, as far as quality, but I know that that's not my level or what I have. So, I mean, I compete with myself, though, a lot. And so if I don't.
Well, I think that's an interesting point. Mm-hmm. Many clients ask me, like, I got that inner critic, and mm-hmm. I want to make it go away so that I can, you know, do this. And I think the real news is it never goes away. The critic never goes away, but you have to sit down with the critic and say, look, this is not your show today. This is not your moment. Your moment's going to come later when we watch the tape. But right now, you got to sit in the back like a good boy and just keep it down while I deliver this message. So again, it's so much about focus. That is not going to go away. Something will always go wrong. I will always be, my body will be, if I'm giving a talk or important presentation or something, my body will be in fight or flight mode. It Right. will be. Your consciousness is giving you sensory input that's flooding you with adrenaline to fight or run away. So your only decision is how you use that energy. That energy is going to be there. Do you want to go off into fear and a spin and, you know, all of that unproductive stuff? Or do you just want to focus? And it's hard. It's not an easy thing.
Yeah.
But a lot of it has to do, I feel like a lot of it has to do with getting rooted in your body, breathing into your belly, keeping your body, you know, what would you call it? You know, erect. Uh-huh. But soft, especially mm-hmm. in the middle of your body, keeping that softness and living with that vulnerability that, you know, that comes from being alive, breathing, aware in your body, and focused moment to moment, idea by idea, story by story, through the truth that you're here to tell. And again, that's where the productive focus lies. And if people stay focused on that and practice it, then they're gonna deliver.
Well, you're bringing up recognition, which I think is what led to my interest in my research for curiosity. I wanted to find out what kept people from being curious. And a lot of the things we're talking about here are what I found out are the factors that inhibit curiosity. And the FATE, F-A-T-E, was the acronym I came up with, which is fear, assumptions, technology, and environment. And the assumptions part is a lot of what we're talking about, you know, that voice in your head that tells you, oh, I'm not going to be good at this. Are you not going to like this? Is it not going to be, you know, and that holds us back from so many things, not just curiosity, but, you know, fear of speaking. You know, assumptions can lead to fear. Some of this stuff overlaps. Yep. And for me, what I found so helpful in my research was just that recognition of what was holding you back. Once you know where you are, you know where to move forward. And I think that that's a really critical part of all this. So
that's right.
You know, and I there's some great TED Talks. I had Kate Adams on my show. She did a cute, really great delivery of the four larger-than-life lessons from soap operas. I don't know if you've seen her TED Talk, but no, she's very enthusiastic. And she worked, you know, for, I don't know if it was All My Children, one of those, soap operas. And she'd worked for them as a writer and a producer or something. And she was really interested in her delivery. But, you know, there's like Sir Ken Robinson, who just kind of stood there and leaned against the wall and was comedic. Is there a TED Talk that's really impressed you? Of course, I'm sure Susan Cain's, but anybody else's that you think was really wonderful?
Yeah, I mean, you brought up the first one I ever saw, which was Ken Robinson. And, you know, I was in education at the time, and it was, you know, it was revolutionary in the sense that, like, kind of what he was saying. But you're absolutely right. His manner was like, he just stands there. Now, you know, again, you can see parallels in comedians. There are comedians who work the stage. They're on a huge stage. They're running up and down. They're really moving through the space. But, you know, somebody like George Carlin or like Jim Gaffigan mm-hmm. are simply standing there delivering their observations. Yeah. And their entire focus, I think a guy like that or somebody like that, their entire focus is on am I have a lot of great ideas. Am I building the ideas to the climaxes that I want them to build to?
Right.
And so their focus is so powerful that you're not aware that they're not moving a lot. So absolutely that Ken Robinson one was great.
Yeah, funny too, you know, but you talk about tension though is the key element of all performances, right?
Absolutely. Wow, that's a very insightful thing. Mm-hmm. So true, tension.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, how do you build absolutely. It?
It depends on what kind of tension you're trying to build, but I think it begins in the writing, mm-hmm. you know, obviously it's got to be in the writing, you know, understanding what to say and what not to say, being brave enough to leave out certain details so that you create a little bit of mystery. A lot of speakers want to come out on stage and just tell everything in the first minute.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's okay to drop a hint and move on mm-hmm. as long as you know you're going to deliver on it. So mm-hmm. there's lots of different
that
lots
is tempting of different for me too. I think, you know, I want to be funny, but because my natural sense of humor is, you know, when I'm talking to somebody, I'm usually funny with them. But when I get on stage, mm-hmm. I don't think I'm funny at all because I get too nervous to be funny sometimes. And I think that, you had mentioned there on one of your talks that there's two parts to the joke, the setup and the payoff. And
right.
I think that the setup is probably the hardest part, right?
Absolutely. Oh, wow. This is very good stuff. Yes. The, mm-hmm. the setup is the hard part. Mm-hmm. Anybody can pay off a joke, mm-hmm. anybody. But if you don't have the setup, if you don't have the right wind up, in other words, I could throw a ball just by flicking my wrist. If I have the ball in my hand, I just flick my wrist and it will go somewhere. But it won't go as far as if I pull my arm all the way back and raise my leg to get my body weight up and then move forward and throw with my entire body. Now it's really going to go somewhere. Mm-hmm. So the tension, that wind up is where the tension is. And yes, you need that. And there are different types of humor that require a different kind of setup. There are different kinds of tension that you want. There's some tension that can come from writing, but there's some tension that can simply come from delivery. And again, when just like with anything else with a speaker, the best situations are where the what you're saying and how you're saying it are completely intertwined and completely organic. So yes, it's absolutely true.
It's very challenging, I think, for a lot of people to think about that setup. And, you know, I think some of the biggest mistakes. I made a mistake telling a joke once and ended up being funnier the way I told it. I was giving a talk about communication to a group of cybersecurity. I don't know who it was, but it was one of my talks I give. And I was giving an example of two of my students in class and how they were talking back and forth. And the one student, Jeffrey, was really obnoxious. And I was showing some of the things he was saying. And then I was telling how Trevor, the other student, it was saving me, you know, by saying certain things because it was an online class. So you can see what they were saying and what they were, you know. And so I was sharing this. And at the end, my joke was, you know, the guy who was rescuing me, Trevor, and I've been married for 5 years kind of thing, is a joke, uh-huh. you know. But instead, I accidentally said Jeffrey. And it was so much funnier because it was so awful, you know.
But because you acknowledged it too. Right?
Yeah. So
you didn't try to dance away from it. You stayed right there.
Right. I owned it because I thought that's, you know, I didn't want him to think that's what I meant, I guess. But it
was because
it was funny. And after that, I always told it that way because it worked.
Very good.
Yeah. I think it's fun to just get some tips from somebody like you. And I know a lot of people who are listening are terrified. They're just terrified of speaking on stage, even Zoom meetings, whatever. Is there any last advice that you'd give to somebody who's listening to this who just can't handle if they sometimes are nominated to speak for something like I was, or they have to just present on a Zoom meeting? Any tips?
Yes, focus on what you need to say or what you want to say, and nothing else. Mm-hmm. Nothing else. Put your entire focus on what you have to say.
Right.
If there was one thing that I would say that would help the most, that's it. I guess the second thing would be the fear may never go away. So refer back to step one.
And, you know, for somebody who's thinking of giving a TED Talk, how much time do they need to prepare, and what would it be like to hire you for that?
I would say don't call me a week before you have to give a talk, mm-hmm. please. I mean, I can help you, but I can't work a miracle. I would say the more time that you can take, the better. I don't work on any kind of, you must pay me, you know, X amount, minimum hours. I try to be, you know, fair, and I know, you know, not everybody is independently wealthy, so mm-hmm. you know, but the more time you can give me, I would say 4 weeks would mm-hmm. be ideal, mm-hmm. you know, 3 to 4 weeks would be ideal before. But if you haven't gotten it written yet, I would say a minimum of 4 weeks. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and then we'll edit back and forth. We'll really, really hone and work on what you have to say, and then we'll work on how you say it. But all of that is really one process with two parts, not two processes.
And
so
how long is the TED Talk that they give? Is it 16? What is the minutes? I don't
know. They've actually gotten shorter.
Are they seven
they
now?
Do mm-hmm. some that are 9 minutes. Okay. They do some that are seven. Mm-hmm. They do some that are, I think the biggest ones they do now are 12, and I think the 18 minute is maybe reserved for like Bill Gates or John Kerry or mm-hmm. something like that. Uh-huh. Somebody who like can take as much time as they want.
Right.
But for most people, they're getting shorter.
And they don't play the Oscar sign off music for them if they go over, I assume.
I don't think they do. I don't think they do. They have it. They submit paperwork to the team of lawyers who represents this person. That's what they do.
I'd be more worried about going under on time, because I know me, when I get nervous, I go way too fast. What happens if you go under?
I'm sure they won't penalize you for it, you know, but if you're going under, it's because you're talking so fast.
Right.
That you probably are going to be very unhappy mm-hmm. when you see the tape. But again, if you work with somebody mm-hmm. and, you know, the TED people have their own coaches that they provide people. Mm-hmm. But, you know, if you've really worked with somebody who knows what they're doing and you have that proclivity already, your coach has already told you, you need to slow so far down in your own head that you sound like that you're going to feel like you're talking underwater. Mm-hmm. Because in other words, if you tend to go that way and rattle, you have to overcompensate by slowing down in your mind so that it feels like you're walking through mud or molasses or something like that. And it won't come out too slow, because you're just mm-hmm. overcompensating for that. Does that make sense?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I gave a talk one time for a you know, brag reel kind of thing. And I was just doing it for that. And I was like, I'm going to go way over the top and just be, you know, because I was watching other people's reels and they were just like super excited. You know how they get. And so I thought I would do it like way over the top. And when I watched it, it didn't seem over the top at all. I was
that's interesting.
Yeah, it was really interesting to me. And it made me realize I need to pick it up a lot in real life.
But my question would be, how big a room were you in?
It was a university room where they would have their events. So it wasn't small room. It was pretty decent sized, but it wasn't huge. There was no one else in the room though, when I was doing this particular part. And so I was doing just a little bit of the pre, you know, and the stuff that you would have as extras. And, that's why I was doing it so crazy. Cause I'm like, let's just be nuts and do it, whatever, you know? And I was really surprised by that. And it made me realize I need to be a lot more, because I'm so loud in normal life. I mean, when people are around me, I'm very, you know, you can't shut me up, and I'm very, hey, somebody needs this quiet, it's going to be me. So it's funny that when I get on stage, I tend to be, you know, I'm great at enunciating or certain things, you know, which is good. You know, you want to be able to hear people, but I'm not as dynamic as I am on a one-on-one basis sometimes. And
well,
I think
would
a lot of people need
if,
to be, I don't know.
Yeah. But I would wonder if that's because you have some notion in your mind that like, oh, you know, a talk is different than just me, Diane.
Yeah, I think Diane. You do. I think you do. You think of it as I'm talking to this group. I got to be a certain way. And I think if it was just one other person you're talking to, it would be a different way. And I think the more I did it, you know, I think a lot of it, you know, when I was talking about assumptions holding us back from curiosity and the things that your environment has done as a pharmaceutical rep, I worked for AstraZeneca 20 years and I was in pharmaceuticals mm-hmm. for 15 of those. And they used to videotape you over and over when you'd start for months and they just critique every single word you said and what, you know, be careful you don't say this and you have to say that. And I think that in some ways that was hard because you're so overcritical because you've had to be criticized so much. You
right,
know what I mean?
Right.
So,
sure.
So that leads to your environmental influences. And I think a lot of it is nobody wants crickets when you tell a joke and nobody wants, you know, to not win when you're a salesperson.
Right.
You're used to everybody responding in a positive kind of way. So I think that a lot of our things that hold us back in curiosity can hold us back on speaking too. So I thought this was such
yep.
a great tie-in. And I was so
yep.
glad that Melody introduced us. This was so much fun having you on the show. And I think a lot
Thank
of people,
you.
Oh, you're welcome, Jim. I think a lot of people are going to want to know how to find you or hire you to help them with their TED Talks or other things. Is there something you'd like to share?
Yes, I have a website. It's my name, Jim Fyfe, and my last name is spelled F as in Frank, Y as in yes, F again, E, so jimfyfe.com. It's all right there, and you can click on a button and email me questions or get in touch with me right from there, so go check it out.
Oh, I hope they do, and this was so much fun. Thank you so much for doing the show, Jim. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you. Me too.
Oh, you're welcome, and we'll be back right after this message.
Curiosity is a critical and direct link to improving motivation and communication-based issues that challenge organizations. By improving workers' curiosity, you can enhance employee engagement, emotional intelligence, innovation, productivity, and many other byproducts that come with that intrinsic but underutilized attribute. To find out more about how to improve curiosity, please go to curiositycode.com.
Well, I want to talk about something a little different today because I have so many people ask me about my podcast and my radio show and how to do this. How did I get into this? How do you figure out how to do it? And just the ins and outs of it. And I have created a course and I do teach people how to do this, but I thought it would be kind of nice to just talk about it today on the show. For those of you who want to know the secrets to creating a popular podcast and radio show, I'm going to just touch on some of the things that I've learned because I had no idea, first of all, that I'd ever have a show. I never had aspired to do this. I had somebody interview me once for my speaking and my consulting, and he had a show. And I really loved just talking to him about what he did, and he shared just some of his tips and tricks that worked for him. And I said, well, how do you get this? And he said, well, you know, I could probably get you a spot. And he found me a spot on his AM/FM station. And because they required live, I mean, the shows would air. They weren't live. They were pre-recorded. But they had airtime that I had to fill. I had to fill 3 hours a week. So it inspired me to continue to interview people and to grow the show. So one of the things I learned was, you know, that there's a lot that goes into it. There's, you know, it doesn't have to be a radio show. It can be just a podcast, or you could even have it on YouTube or a website. And there's all kinds of platforms involved when you create your own show. So you kind of have to have an idea of, you know, how much you want to spend, because it's going to cost you money initially, unless you have somebody that you can get a company or some other way to fund it or monetize it, which is very difficult. And we'll get a little more into that. But initially, you're going to have to host it somehow on your website or on a podcast site or on YouTube or somewhere. So you have to keep that in mind. the radio stations, some of them will charge you for airtime, so you would own your time slot. For my show, I air at 10 a.m. Monday, Wednesday, and Friday Eastern time on many different markets throughout the United States. And so that's my airtime. And I could talk about this. I could talk about anything. I could interview someone, or I could just do advertisements for everything I sell the whole time. I could do whatever I want is my point. So that's kind of nice. The only thing I can't do is let people swear on the air or something like that. But in general, it's pretty open, and it's a nice option if you want to do a combination podcast radio show like I do. I also put my show on YouTube and all the links to it on my website, so I make sure it's everywhere. The hardest part for me initially was just setting up the hardware. I wasn't really sure how I wanted to do it. I was using Zoom for some initial things, but the sound wasn't quite as good, and you couldn't separate the tracks from my track from the guest track if I had an issue on one of the tracks, for example. So initially, I went with using my phone. I wanted people to be able to call into the show. The problem I was having was I usually like to use PCs, and my PC didn't have the best software. I didn't like any of the software for all the editing, and I do a lot of video and audio editing with Camtasia, which I love, and I wanted it to be really simple like that. But getting the audio from the phone into the computer was a lot more challenging than I had anticipated. And that to me, for I guess, was the hardest part, which is silly because it turned out all you needed to do was go to Guitar City and they'll tell you how to do it, basically. But I bought a Focusrite, which is the adapter box that connects to your computer. And there's a cord that comes off of that. And I just bought a little adapter that went on to the cord that would fit into the cell phone. So when somebody would call in, I just take this plug and plug it into the phone, and it goes through this Focusrite equipment, which goes right into the Mac. I used Mac because I liked GarageBand the best for the software. And it, you know, as long as you have a good microphone and headset to listen, you're set. It is pretty easy to edit and capture data through the Focusrite equipment, captures it and goes right into the Apple device. So that worked really well for me. I also use Zoom sometimes, and then I'll edit what I get from Zoom with Camtasia, which is a software editing for, you can do so much with it, I love it. It's great for video editing, you know, I use it more for that, but you could do audio editing. And I think if you have options, so if they call in on the phone and you're having phone issues, and then you send them a Zoom link, you could do it that way if you need to. And it's also important to be able to do that for people who are in other countries. Maybe they can call in through WhatsApp, which is an app that doesn't charge them. That's another option for people. So depending whether you want to use your phone, you want to use Zoom or something like Zoom, there's a lot of other options that are similar to Zoom that you can use. But what I found was Mac and GarageBand worked great. I got Shure, S-H-U-R-E, SRH 240 headphones. I got the Focusrite Scarlett interface, and I got a Sterling Audio S50 microphone. And then that adapter that plugs into your Apple device, your Apple phone, is the Lightning to 3.5 millimeter headphone jack adapter. So if you can remember those things and write them down, listen to this a few times to write those very fascinating things down, that's basically all you need to record into a Mac. And you just make sure you have GarageBand installed. So what I found was it was much easier to create a shell, like a dummy file, that had all my files in it. Like, you don't just record without an intro, a music, or outro music, or ads, or whatever you're gonna put in your show. You've got to have music, you have to have welcome to the show kind of stuff. So I created little files onto a recording onto my GarageBand, saying that, you know, this is the Dr. Diane Hamilton Show or whatever it is it says at the beginning. And I didn't actually record my own. I paid for files to be created. I did a lot through Fyver, F-I-V-R-R or E-R, I can't remember how you spell it. Look up Fyver, I think there's two R's online. And you can get voiceovers and different things, and they'll give you a little sound file, MP4, MP3, whatever they save it as, and you can put that into your shell that you create. So what I do is I have an intro at the beginning of the shell, I have an outro at the end. And so the intro would be the guy saying, and here's Diane kind of thing. And then the outro would be just the music ending the show. And I have those saved so that I don't have to put those in every single time. I also put in three separate ads, which is how many ads I like to have on my show. And I save those to drag them around to wherever I'm going to edit them later. And the ads, I do the ads myself. I like to have in my voice usually, but sometimes I'll go to Fyver or someplace else to have them create an ad. Or if you have a sponsor, they have ads they can give you. But the point is saving your document. This is like a file that, so you don't have to keep putting ads in all the time or keep putting the intro or outro music in all the time. And then I just save it as shell on my desktop. And every time I have a new show, I open up that shell document and then I save it as the new name of whoever is on the show. And that works out really well for me. So when I first started, I wasn't sure where else I wanted to host the podcast, because you want it to get onto iTunes and different places, right? And so I think I started with Podcast Garden originally because it was cheap. And I know a lot of people like Libsyn, L-I-B-S-Y-N, I think it is. There's a lot of podcast hosting sites. There's Blog Talk, there's all these different things. And I ended up with Podtize because BrandcastU is a group I used, that Tom Hazard is the guy there that I use. And he does a great job because he transcribes the show and he puts in all these tweetable moments and pictures and all these different things. And he hosts it on Podtize for me. But that's really the only thing I have somebody else do for me. And I only started having him do it when I wanted the transcription. Basically, it's really easy to get on a site like the ones I was on before, or Libsyn or one of those. And you can get some of your data records. They'll tell you how you're doing. And it's kind of nice to get your statistics. And you can find out how many people are listening to your show and all that. And those will usually have ways for you to have them shared through iTunes and different means. Because I know my show's on iTunes, iHeart, Roku, you name it. It goes everywhere. And a lot of it Tom does with Podtize for me. But I was able to do a lot of it myself whenever I hosted it myself as well. So I think it's good to look at your options for, if do you want transcription? Do you just want the sound? And if you're doing the sound, what are you using? GarageBand? Are you using Camtasia? Are you using Zoom? Are you using Skype? You know, Zencaster's one. A lot of people do. Are you going to do your own editing? I like to do my own editing. I don't do a lot of it. I kind of like it natural. If somebody says something, I don't necessarily want to change it. I think that it's real. I've had to cut out one or two different things. If somebody was driving in their car and a police stopped them for being on their cell phone, well, that got cut out. But other than that, I pretty much left it in unless it was something that I thought was a super inappropriate thing to say. And I think I only did that once, that I had to cut something out. But I think one of the hardest things when you first start is finding the right guests. And a lot of people ask me about that. I would go to speaker sites a lot of times to look at the top speakers, but my initial guests I got were, I was the MBA program chair at the Forbes School of Business, so part of my time there was working with the board members, and some of the board members did the show. Steve Forbes was one of them, who was wonderful to do my show. But before I even asked Steve or the other board members, I went to some of the speakers we had who had spoken for our school, which were a lot of the Forbes 30 under 30s young people who had just become very successful and were looking for more publicity. So looking at sites like that, people who had just been nominated and received some kind of honor would be a great place to start. And when you get people who have recognition behind their name like that, and then you could show that you're not just interviewing just anybody, you're having good, solid people on your show. And going to speaker sites, are, you know, you might get some of them. So some of them might turn you down. Sometimes I get newsletters from different sites that say this person's speaking here or there, and I'll connect with them on LinkedIn and say, oh, I saw you're speaking at this event. Love to have you on the show, kind of thing. Sometimes they're at conventions. You see them speaking at conventions. You see them on LinkedIn with a great post and people following them. There's so many ways. And then once you start getting people on the show, at the end of the show, after you get off the air, I would talk to them and ask them if they thought, you know, if they thought of anyone that would be a great guest. I'd love to have them on the show. So those are ways of just expanding your reach. Some of the best people I've had on my show were suggestions from other people who had been on my show. And I think that that's one of the things that a lot of people forget to do, is to ask for just a referral. Who would you think would be great? Who's got a new book coming out? Who's, whatever you're trying to find for a guest. And a lot of what goes along with the show is creating graphics. And I know Tom creates some stuff for me for my website, but I also was doing it long before he did any of the graphics. And I used Canva a lot for that. I also, you know, there's VizMe, there's all these different, you can have a virtual assistant do it for you. You can hire somebody. I think Canva's great. It's one of the easiest platforms. I use it for everything. I'm not affiliated with any of these names that I've mentioned so far, just so you know. I think these are all just great programs. And you can create a graphic. I'd come up with a overall graphic that designed for the show and just keep changing the picture for the guest, whoever the guest is on the show. That's how I did it. It worked out well for me. And then, you know, you just, to find more people, you just start networking and you get your circle of influence and you ask them if they know people, and you go on social media and you tag everybody when you're posting these shows. Make sure you tag the people who are in your show and you have hashtags for whatever you talk about on the show. On Twitter, I have Dr. Diane Radio is a hashtag, so all of my shows, if you click on that hashtag, you'd be able to find them all really easily. And you're going to do that throughout social media, and I think that's really important. And when you're on the show, thinking about the questions is an interesting thing, because I always ask my guests to give me questions that they'd like to ask. And I don't go down the list and just ask them those questions, but I have them so I can think about the kinds of things they like to ask, to be asked. And when I first started, I would create a whole bunch of questions before the show. I would go through everybody's bio and read everything about them and watch all their videos and do everything I could to research them. And I still do a lot of that, but I don't create questions like I used to. And I don't spend the same amount of time, because I find that a lot of what I want to ask, I learn while we're on the show. But if they have a TED Talk or if they have something that's pretty, you know, important, I watch that for sure. And I think the questions are really important to have them send you. When they sign up for the show, I use Schedule Once, which it'll send them, you know, a notification to put for their calendar and reminders, and it'll ask them, please, you know, give me your bio and your headshot and any questions you want me to ask. And what I find I do is, while we're talking, I start writing questions down on a pad of paper. If they say something, I'll make a note like, oh, I'm interested in this or that. And I might circle something that I want to come back to. And I think all those notes are really just my way of keeping track of what we're talking about and what I want to ask next. But I also sometimes ask them things off the air if I don't want to put them on the spot. So I might make a note of something I want to ask later. So there's a lot of things that continue on our discussions after we get off the air. I usually schedule them for an hour. Most guests I don't keep for an hour on the show. I think it's a long time to interview somebody, but I do have some for that long. I sometimes do 2 25-minute shows, and then I add them together and put ads. So you have to decide how long you want to talk to somebody and how you want to set it up. But I schedule an hour so that we have time to talk after the show, and it's not just like, oh, thank you and goodbye and hang up on them, because I think that that's pretty uncomfortable, and it's nice to build that relationship afterwards. But beforehand, I think there's a lot of preparation that you need to do. I think, you know, you look at their LinkedIn profile, you look at their websites, you look at their YouTube. If they have a book, you look on Amazon, you read about, sometimes their bio's really good in Amazon and not so good on LinkedIn. Sometimes it's the other way around. Read their bios, find them online, learn as much as you can about them. Read the description of their book, because that's important. And just get, you know, prior to the show, sent, you know, I'll ask for all the things that you asked for before the show. And then after the show, I think, you know, you either thank them, you send them a note. For me, when the show comes out, I thank them. I send them all the links. I send them the graphics that they can post. And I ask them to post a testimonial. If you go to drdianehamilton.com/testimonials, you can see what people have said, and I think it's really great because it links to their site and it gets them noticed and it gets you some great stuff on your website. So, you know, when the show comes out, you post it all over social media. You might have a newsletter, you put it in that. If you do retweets on the sites like Meet Edgar or whatever sites you use to repost things, you could put it in there. And as I said, I transcribe the blog, which gives you a lot of content for your site, because you got to think, if you do an hour show and that's a lot of words of people coming to your site, I think it's really great for later advertising and taking advantage of that traffic. So a lot of people do shows for different opportunities. You might be a consultant or a speaker, or want to be on boards, or you want to go to events and shows or different things. The radio show can do a lot for you, or the podcast can do a lot for you. I had no intention of using it for anything other than my curiosity to find out about people and learn what made them successful. But it did lead to a lot of things. I do a lot more speaking and more consulting, and I'm on more boards, and I've found companies in which I was interested in investing, and things like that can happen. And I think, you know, having an, you know, being realistic that this is not going to be something that you're going to probably be able to monetize, that if you want to monetize it, you're probably going to have a better chance of monetizing it through the things it leads to than to get sponsors, because you have to have quite a few downloads. There's a few people who can monetize their shows, but the majority aren't able to. So be realistic. Think about the return on investment and the traffic and all the things. You know, think of your show as kind of a loss leader, similar to a book. Most people do not make money off of their books. They're making it from the things the books lead to. And just make sure that when you schedule things, that you use a good calendar for everything to keep track of it. Like I said, I use Schedule Once. I like it. I'm able to just send the link to people, say, here's how you sign up. And then I've set it up to ask them to give me all the information. And then I schedule follow-up reminders, and they're able to reschedule. So all that stuff is really important. I also want you to think about any potential issues you can run into, like sound quality, if they're calling long distance, if you've dropped a line, you know, there's some editing that might be required. And some of this stuff, it's really a good learning experience. And if you don't think you like it, don't rule it out until you've tried it, because there's a lot that goes into it, and you can learn a lot. There are some negative things. Some people ask me sometimes if you have like any guests or rude or anything like that. I have had very few problems with guests. You have to remember, you're providing free showcasing of what they do. You're doing them a favor for free, really, if you think about it. There's some who will kind of bully you or overanalyze. I mean, you're doing this for free, and they may just say, oh, I wanted to say this. Can you edit that, or can you do this? And, you know, as a guest, I would suggest not doing that if you're on other people's shows, because you have to realize, after I've had thousands of people on my show now, that's a lot of work that it's really hard to go back and just micromanage every single show. And I think people aren't worried if something like is transcribed not perfect. People realize it's transcription, for example. But some guests might not value your time. They want to meet and talk about the show and spend a lot of time doing things before the show. And for me, I found shows are a lot better if you don't meet prior to them, because you will ask them everything you want to ask, and then when you get on the show, you're not as inquisitive, it's not as fresh, and I avoid meeting guests prior to the show. As I said, you can own your own airtime. Of course, if it's a podcast, you definitely do. And so it's good to refer to your site once in a while. I mentioned before that you could go to drdianehamilton.com/testimonials. It's just part of my conversation. But that's referring to my site. And if you were going to refer to your site for sales of something, I might say go to curiositycode.com, because that's where I would sell my Curiosity Code Index. So I use the site once in a while for things like that, but I also have ads between guests that talk about my assessments or my certification trainings and all the things I do. So you want to tie into what you do when you're doing your ads and speaking alone. Like right now, I'm speaking alone, and that's harder because it's not, you're not going off of what somebody else has already said. Even just saying that was not as smooth as if I had somebody on the air. It's not scripted, but you know, you can script your show. I don't like to do that. I talk off the top of my head, and I get some great sound bites that I could use, but maybe not. You know, and when you're speaking alone, I think the hardest part for me is at the beginning of the show. What I do is when they get on my show, I'll introduce them, read their bio, and we start to chat. And then later, depending on if I have one person or two people on the show, I don't know usually, so I see how the shows go, and if I decide to just have one or two or whatever, I then create the intro to discuss who's on the show that day to get people interested. Well, that's the part where I'm speaking alone when it's later, and I have the hardest time doing that for some reason, just to say who's on the show and what we're going to talk about. Sometimes I have to redo that like 3 or 4 times. It drives me crazy. I don't know why that's so hard for me. But I think a lot of people will start to contact you to get people on your show. PR people contact me constantly. I get people signing into my site looking to be on the show. I have an outgoing message that says, if you meet the requirements, we'll get back to you, because I get too many people who will have weird content that has nothing to do with what my show's about contact me. So you want to make sure they're a good match for your show, and you have some kind of a thing that says, I'm sorry, you know, that I can't, you know, we can't have everybody on the show. And so that's really important that you take a look and you build good relationships with the PR people so that they know who to send to you. And when you're planning things, you have your content calendar. On schedule once, I'll go in and I'll pick the times that I will allow, you know, the show to be scheduled, and I take holidays off. And some of the stuff, it's almost always a new show, but I take a couple weekends or weeks, like during the holidays, where I'll have reruns, and you can just have some content that's evergreen. Like this is an evergreen type of a show until there's no such thing as a podcast or whatever. This is pretty constant. So as long as you have constant evergreen content, you can replay these kinds of shows over more than once, and they're good things for reruns. One thing I found was that there's a lot of stuff that I like that they put into my transcribed shows that I hadn't been doing, like tweetable moments and visuals and bulleted points and different things. I think that it's really nice to look at a bunch of people's blogs that they've set up from their shows to see what they share, what they conclude, and pick and choose what you want to have on your site from the show. You can also have a lot of different areas on your website, landing pages that you might mention. As I said, refer back to your website when you're on the air, but you're going to need to buy maybe some site URLs if you're giving away certain things or landing pages in general. So something to think about. You can also have affiliates or be an affiliate and have a lot of different aspects. I recommend looking up affiliate programs if you want to have people be affiliates for any of your products. With me, I have assessments, and so I have landing pages for that. So think about the kinds of things you want to talk about when you're referring to your site. If you know, when people are trying to get on the show, it's really important that they send me they call it a one sheet. You know, they have types of things that they include, like their bio, their picture, their questions. I think it's good to give an example of what you'd like to people if you have one. Like, this is a kind of a bio that works great, this is the kind of picture we'd like to see, and this is the kind of questions. But you don't have to have that. But I think the best people know what to send when they give you their information, and they don't always. So that's why I put it in the calendar invitation of what I'd like. And then once they get into your Schedule Once app, you can connect that to AWeber or whatever database that you use, and then you can keep track of everybody. I like to keep a personal database of on ACT because it's an old program and I'm just used to it and I love it, but I have AWeber as well. But it's good for when you're, if you send newsletters, and it just, there's just make sure whatever you send to your database adds value and you don't spam them or overwhelm them, and that they've opted in and all that. If you do that, I notice I go on a lot of people's shows and they'll automatically put me into a mailing database, and I haven't signed up for anything. Or if even if they're on my show, they put me in their database, and I don't recommend doing that. But you can grow your following through LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and all that. And that's what really is helpful. The more content you have out there and the more you like other people's content and share of what they're doing, the bigger you can grow your following. Just don't make the mistake of having a sale in mind if you have somebody coming on your show. Like if you invite a CEO on your show because you want to get his business, well, that's nice if that's in the back of your head, but if that's what really what you come across as what you're doing, that's bad. I've never done that, but I know a lot of people do that they want to be hired by this company, so I will just interview this person, and that's what they do. But if you're going into it having a sale in mind, asking for favors, wanting to spam them and not showcasing them, that's a huge mistake. And if you are thinking about being on somebody else's show, just to be a good guest, always have good stories. Refer to your site once in a while, but don't overdo it. You can say it at the end if they're going to let you say it at the end, but just pay attention to time and talk in sound bites. Don't have super long times where you have no break at all and that you just keep talking. And you can always offer free information. I think that's always a good thing. Hey, get a free chapter at my site, if you go here and go there and that type of thing. But as I said, I don't think you should meet prior to the show. I think it kind of takes away from it. And I think that just jumping in and having a lively conversation is the best way, at least it is for me. So I hope that this was helpful to you. If you want to go to my site to listen to my shows, you can go to drdianehamilton.com. And you could go to the blog to read it. You could go to the radio section to listen to it. But you could actually listen to it on the blog as well. So hope you found this interesting. And I think it's fun to talk about this stuff.
Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate.
Well, I'd really like to thank Jim for being my guest today. We get so many great guests on the show. If you've missed any past episodes, please go to drdianehamilton.com. Check out all the drop-down menus at the top and at the bottom because you can read the show and listen to it and find out more things from our testimonials to curiosity code information or perception power information. So I hope you take that time to do that. And I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio.